God is good. Amen. Pastor Ezekiel and the rest of the crew, God bless you guys. Amen. You know, as I was pondering coming here today, just sometimes we spend our time preparing, believing that we have the message that God wants to provide for his people. And I've been in this space where I've really just been spending time with the Holy Spirit and allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to me at a higher level. Because, again, I want to increase every opportunity, every day that God gives me. 24/7 is not enough, you know, but in God it is. Amen. And every day for me is a Kairos moment. It's an opportunity for God to show me that he transcends dispensation and time. And his word, somebody say his word. His word is everlasting. And it's in the word that we learn how to be and to grow and become everything that God wants us to be. So tonight I'm going to speak to you based upon what the Spirit of God gave me, not what Pastor Cy prepared. So the message that God wants me to share with you all tonight is simple. Tonight you get a chance to understand your spiritual identity. Now, let me be clear. In our world today, one of the biggest challenges that we find in the world today that we see amongst our people is the struggle of understanding who we are. When somebody asks you, who are you? We tend to tell people what we do. We tend to express what we have accomplished and all of these things, defining ourselves by what it is that we do. Amen? But when you really go by biblical context, prophet, when you go to Genesis chapter 1 and you start reading from verse 26, which we'll do here in a minute, you will see that the understanding we miss when we read the Bible is that God is spirit. God is spirit. So your first identity is first spiritual. Everything it is that you need to know about yourself is first predicated upon your relationship with a God you can't see. The Bible says that no man has seen God. God is spirit. So if you haven't seen God, the image in which God made you was first in the image of your spirituality before he breathed on you and gave you flesh. The Bible also said that God made man from the dust of the earth. Dust. When you look at dust in the Hebrew, it means a useless thing. You can't build a house with dust. You can't shift anything with dust. In fact, we tend to get rid of dust. We blow and it moves. But isn't it unique that your God will look at the useless thing, the thing that's not worthy enough to make anything out of and make you, sending a message to the world that I, God, I take the dumb things to human beings. And that the stuff that we just play down, and that's the stuff he uses to turn the world upside down. Are you listening to me? So tonight we're going to understand our spiritual identity, because when we understand our spiritual identity, we don't get caught up in the definitions the world tries to put on us as believers. Are you listening to me? When we begin to walk in the trueness of who we really are in him, how he made us to be, then we tend to walk in the authority and the power that he originated from the beginning of time. Can I walk with you tonight? Are you with me? Go with me to Genesis chapter 1. We're going to start reading to verse 26. Then we're going to go to verse 27. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not going to be in front of y'all long. This is easy. Let the Holy Spirit speak.
Any particular version?
King James. New King James.
Then God said,
mm-hmm.
Let us make man in our image,
mm.
according to our likeness.
Mm-hmm.
Let them have dominion,
mm-hmm.
over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, mm-hmm. he created them.
Stop. So let's break this down. So God said, let us. circle us. Circle us. Let us, what is us? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. What is us? Creator, Word, Implementer, Blueprint, Holy Spirit. The Bible says God and the Spirit, what? God hovered over the earth when it was dark. When you look at the text, what is being talked about is at a time where devils didn't have access to anything. They couldn't move, prophet. They have been thrown from the earth. God now, from the heavens, and now God creates the earth because the whole world was dark. And out of darkness, he brings light. Light be. He puts things into order because he's a God of order. And then after he puts everything in order by his word, speaking, calling it in. The image of God looks nothing like you, your flesh. The image of God is spirit. It is designed to create. It is designed to make things happen. He said, let's make it in our image. What is it? After our likeness. What is the likeness of God? I'm looking at people in the room. We all look different. But what you're looking at is flesh made, is dust made flesh. But the real God in you is the Spirit of God in you. When you go to Genesis chapter 2 and 7, he says, and God breathed into man. In other words, the Ruach of God. He breathed into man. Man now becomes a living soul, a thing that can think, that has emotions, that can speak just like God. Genesis chapter 1 is the mind of God. We are walking through the mind of God in Genesis chapter 1. This is what God saw in Genesis chapter 1. When you go to Genesis chapter 2, it is now being translated from what we see to now the manifestation of that which we see. So everybody in this room has the power to envision a thing, and by the power of God in you, you can call those things that be not as though they were. Oh, y'all got to understand. Prophecy was happening in Genesis chapter 1 before we saw it in Genesis chapter 2. By the Spirit of the living God. He said, let us make man in our image. Let them have a likeness as to who we are. He has a likeness to us. What does that mean? It means that he thinks. He creates. He has dominion. He has rule. So God makes Adam prophet out of the dust of the earth. But when you read the bottom of the scripture, when we get to the bottom part, okay? Now, he gives us authority over the birds of the field. He gives us authority over the sea. He gives us authority over every creeping thing. Yeah, ladies. God gave the power to identify creeps. Every creeping thing. What was the snake? So he gives us that authority. And then this is the part. But when God made everything, then God said that he made male and female. He made them both. The part that became a revelation for me, it was when God now knew that he had put something in Adam, the power to identify and to see things and to call those things that he see. So Adam now, prophet, when you look at it, God starts to watch how Adam takes care of the garden, starts to do the things that he does, right? But there was a desire inside Adam that kept popping up. There was something there as Adam was taking care of the garden. Why? Because in Adam, God hid the part of Adam that Adam had to bring to reality. God hid woman in male. It could have only come by the Spirit, not by flesh. Okay, I'm not going to get too deep. I'm just giving you a revelation by the word of God. When we look at this and we start to dig into it, useless substance, unuseful substance, dust is what he made man for. But then what did he do? He put something inside of man that when man got a revelation of what that was he needed, then God was going to release it. Like with so many of us here tonight, listen to me. There is something God has put inside of you that can only manifest when you come into a spiritual alignment with God. When that desire now starts to prick you, something that can keep you up all night, you can't sleep. It's not about the work you do. It's not about the job you do. It's not about your career. But God puts something inside of you that when it starts to wake you up at night and it starts to move on you, then God comes in and starts to render unto you the desires of your heart. So we see Adam now, he's moving through and he's taking care of stuff. So here's what God says. When you go to Genesis chapter 5. Remember now, Genesis chapter 26, I think it's the problem of Adam. Because there's something inside of him he needs to push. But God didn't reveal it until there was a desire. Now here is how God did the test, prophet, to see if Adam will catch the revelation. Because at that time, Adam had power. Read. Genesis 5, 1, 2, 6. Just start reading 1 and 2. Let's keep going.
This book.
Genesis chapter 5, starting in verse 1.
Yes, sir. This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. In the day that God created man, he made him in the likeness of God.
Mm-hmm.
He created them, male and female, and blessed them and called them mankind in the day they were created. And Adam lived 130 years.
Read it from another version. What version was that?
This New King James.
Okay, go to King James.
Amplified. Oh.
There's a word I'm trying to get there.
Verse 1, King James.
Mm-hmm.
This is the book of the generations of Adam. Mm-hmm. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God, made he him.
Mm-hmm.
Male and female created he them.
He them.
And blessed them.
And blessed them.
And called their name.
What?
Adam.
Adam. When he called him Adam, he was not just speaking to man by himself. He was calling both male and female Adam. Oh, yes, stay with me. We're going somewhere. He called both of them Adam. The person that writes takes us back to Genesis chapter 1 and reminds us this is how God did it. Created them both male and female inside this one person. Are you with me? He created them and he puts them inside this one person. Then God now tests Adam by doing what? God brings before Adam. Now, y'all listen to me. We know that people teach us and they say, well, Adam named the animals. No, no. If you read the text said, and God brought the animals before him to see what he would name them or what he would call them. In other words, God knew what he put in Adam. He knew that if Adam had the revelation of the God in him, whatever he called it, God signed off on it. You understand? Your spiritual identity is beyond how you look. Your spiritual identity gives you more power to do better than you've ever done before. So when God started to parade the animals in front of Adam, he was looking to see if Adam had spiritual wherewithal to identify creation. And as they passed and what he did, right? God said, okay. I understand now. So as Adam began to see that, Adam was like, male, female, male, female, male, female, male, female. What about me? And the desire kicked in. And God now speaks and says, it is not good for man to be alone. So now God had to bring out the problem, the thing that was in Adam that was nudging at him saying, it's time for me to come out. May this year, may that which God has placed inside of you bother you, keep you up, continue to pursue him until you birth the promise that God has for you. Are you hearing me? Because what God has inside of you gives you added life for generations to come. Somebody shout hallelujah. He said, now it's not good for man to be alone. It's not good for man to be alone. Some of us today, listen to me. Some of us today, when we live our lives, we try to live it based upon our own way of thinking, what we call ourselves to be. That's why the enemy will kick in and give you an animal or a monkey, and you want to call the elephant or the gorilla or something your wife or your husband. Because you have no discernment or spiritual alignment with your God for God to speak to you and say to you, this is what. When God put Adam to sleep and took a rib and created what was in him, and then what did he do? The same thing he did with the animals. He presented her before Adam to do what? To see what Adam will call her. Not God, Adam. God didn't name Eve. It was Adam. Adam said, oh, bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Then what did he do? Then he moved into prophesying. Therefore, you shall leave your father and mother, and then you shall cleave unto me. Prophecy was taking place in the garden before we can see it today. He began to speak to his future. Because what's in you will cause you to speak to your future. Oh, y'all got to hear me. What God puts inside of you, when it's coming for you, when it's tugging at you, he said in his word, you shall delight in the Lord also, and he will give you the desires of your heart. What does that mean? It means God has already placed it in you. You're not defined by your divorce. You're not defined by your job that fired you. You're not defined by people that gossip about you. What you're defined by is what God has placed in you. Greatness is in you. When God breathed in you, he put himself in you. He covered you in flesh. Now, when he did that, here's the other part. That same spiritual identity, when Eve comes now, and your bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, Adam was so busy taking care of business, didn't have time to debate, because Adam knew who he was. Satan comes now, and the devil comes now, and let me tell y'all something. It was until flesh was made that demons decided to have access to the earth. Because until then, they were just roaming all over the place in darkness. So what did he do? He got into a creeping thing. Now, the reality of our current day says that the enemy, Lucifer, has been defeated by Christ, right? And he's under my feet. Am I speaking to y'all? Y'all got it? Somebody say hallelujah. He's under your feet, correct? Because that's where God sent him, in the garden. And then it was manifested when he resurrected and was defeated. And Jesus took his rightful place up in heaven and sitting on a throne. The Bible says in Ephesians that he was then, Lucifer, was placed under his feet. And we who are in him also have authority. He is under our feet. Lucifer, knowing what he was, that he had been defeated, when he came into the garden, the first thing he did was he tested the mind of Eve. And when Eve couldn't speak straight to what it was she knew, he said, oh, she don't really know what she got. You see, she said, we can eat everything in this garden except the tree. No. God said, it is the day that you eat of the tree. A certain degree of knowledge will come to you, but then what happens is now you go into perishing. So he tells Eve this. Eve didn't communicate it right. Adam comes along because this girl is just bad. Every time he gets around her, he loses his focus. And then he eats. And all of a sudden now we have a problem. Are you guys hearing me? We have a problem now in the garden. And now we have failed the test. The first Adam fails the test. How did he fail it? The lust of the eyes. Come on now. The lust of the flesh. The pride of life. Happened in the garden. So God kicks in his redemptive plan to say now, because this has been shifted, the only way I can make this work is that I come out of my spiritual realm and then get into my, make a body for me to enter the earth realm. Why? Because God didn't change that. God now gave man authority over the earth realm. He couldn't just come in any kind of way. It needed a body to access it so that he can do what he wanted to do. Oh, y'all go with me. When you go with me to Luke chapter 4, you see that the Bible says that. And after Jesus was filled with the Spirit, after he had come out, he was led into the wilderness for his testing. Second Adam. It's a spiritual thing, but he had to come to break the notion that it was about the way you think. Nuh-uh. You were already created to abound in all good works. You were already created to move in things that no other man can shift. God put you in a position and give you spiritual authority and spiritual wealth to override whatever the enemy would throw at you. First Adam failed the test. Jesus comes now. Y'all see how the Bible is similar. This time Jesus has fasted for 40 days, 40 nights. When Lucifer addressed Eve in the garden, it was a test of whether she knew who she was. How did Lucifer address Christ? If you say, if you are. In other words, wanted to see if this flesh person knew who he really was, because the first flesh missed it. And when he did that, he also knew Jesus had the power to turn stones to bread. And had he done that, he would have lost his spiritual position. And you and I won't be sitting here today. His identity was not tied to his flesh. His identity was tied in his knowledge of where he knew everything that happened upon creation was by a spoken word. So when he came to test him, what did he do? The same, try this, see how it tastes, was the same thing he tried. Let me tell you something. Devil doesn't have any new tricks. The same thing he did, then he's going to try to do it again. The difference is he would do it in a different way with a different dress on. Maybe he got braids in his hair this time when he shows up, but he's still the devil. Am I speaking to you? Mm-hmm. Gentlemen, the first girl that got you in trouble was a certain package. Yeah. You went on about your business. 10 years later, another one showed up, looked exactly like the last one, sounded like the one you left before that put you in all that trouble. Uh-huh. Can I speak to you? Got you in all that trouble the first time. Show up. You haven't done anything to change your perspective and understanding who you are. So she comes again. This time with a red dress on. They made a song about her. Lady in red. Are you with me? Are you with me? Somebody shout hallelujah. You have spiritual power. Your identity is not predicated upon your flesh. And your need, listen to me, God is not moved by your need, because your need is not an absence of God. It is just that it is God showing you that he can manifest whatever you desire. The need to be powerful is your right as a child of God. It is your right to advance. It is your right to abound. It is your right to walk in power. It is your right to exceed. It is your right to have all that God has promised concerning your life. Why? When you give your life to God, you instantly become saved spiritually. You are now put back into your rightful place of authority, and that's what Jesus had to do in order to give us the strength and the authority today that we can move and walk in. Now God's redemptive plan is in place. Oh, can I keep going, prophet? I'm almost done. The other thing I want you to understand me tell you is that when God brought Adam, Eve, when he created Eve, the bride of Adam, so it was that when Christ was crucified on the cross, remember now, Eve came from the rib, the side, and was created to be the bride of Adam. When you look at the church today, when you look at what Christ's finished work was on Calvary, spiritually, the Bible says while he was on the cross, he was pierced in the side, and both blood and water came out. The blood spoke to the sanctification, the water spoke to the flow of nature, the power that he had. And now that became the birthing of the church, the creation of the church. So the church is the bride of Christ. As much as we are here to serve the church, we're not married to the church. This church is the bride of Christ. We come as eunuch to prepare this bride so that when he comes, we can present her with no blame. Are y'all listening to me? So the Bible speaks and brings revelation into itself. The rightful place of man in Christ speaks to the rightful place of man from the garden. The image of God looks nothing like you and me because it's spirit. Your need in this earth realm today, listen to me. Your need in this earth realm is not absence of God, but is awakening of what God has for you. Look around you today. Why is it you think that you find yourself constantly thinking about how to create, how to birth something better than you've had before? It was God's will for you, and is still his will for you, to prosper, to be fruitful, to multiply. You see, when God made Adam, Adam's ears were closed to the be fruitful part because Eve was locked inside of him. How can that be? Everybody else is fruitful. Oh God, I need for me to say, and then when she came, the fruitfulness manifested because his need now was awakened to show him what God had for him. Are you hearing me? In this year, y'all listen to me. In this year, somebody say this year. May God awaken the manifestation of your greatest power, your greatest need. Whatever that is, listen to me, it's not even about what God is trying to tell you to go do. It's what he has already done for you to manifest it. And by your word, by you tapping into the word of God, which has the answer to everything you need. Jesus dealt with Lucifer with the word. He said, oh yeah, I can turn rocks into bread tonight. But guess what? It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. You know why? He had to take him back to what happened in the garden. When God was creating the world, he spoke everything into existence. And after he did that, he said, now let's make man in our image. In other words, you man have the same creative power to speak those things. Let it be said of you when you raise your hand, knowing your spiritual identity, you will say, I am. In the name of Jesus. I have in the name of Jesus. I can do in the name of Jesus. That's your identity. You can be the president of a corporation. That doesn't define you. You can be a multi-millionaire. If you know God, if you know him for yourself, what defines you is the spirit man in you. Not what you do. Who are you? When people ask you, who are you? I'm a child of the Most High God. First and foremost, I walk in the abundant authority that he has left for me. I walk in divine wisdom. I have the power to call those things that be not as though they are. I walk in great expectation. Why? Because he told me, for I know the thoughts and plans that I have towards you. They are thoughts of good and not of evil. And they are thoughts that will bring you to an expected end. What are you expecting in 2023? What are you believing God for? It will manifest for you when you know who you are. Your God is not bipolar. Therefore, you are not bipolar. Your God is not wishy-washy. Therefore, you are not wishy-washy. Your God is not poor. Therefore, you are not poor. Am I speaking to you today? Your God has the power to call, to speak things into existence. You too, made in his creative genius, you have the power to do the same. Sickness can't hold you because sickness, God says, I will remove it from you. And through Jesus Christ, sickness, every disease has been removed from you. Am I speaking to you? Everything that has been broken in your life, when you give your life to the Lord, according to Joel chapter, he said, I will restore unto you the years. Listen to me. This is the year that everything you lost over the last 5 years, God will bring it back to you double. He will give you more than you've ever had, more you can wrap your mind around. You will do exceedingly abundantly above all that God has ever. Oh, y'all got to hear me tonight. Sunday, I started talking about the power of expectation. The power of expectation is what we're going to flow with, because you cannot have what you're not expecting. Your God, when he showed up on the scene, he was expecting to see light come out of darkness. He was expecting to see the earth divide when he said it. He was expecting to see man be created by breath. And because he expected it, everything he said manifested. You shall have what you say. If you believe, you shall have what you say. Be it unto you according to as you believe. First Adam missed it. Second Adam, Christ, fixed it and brought us back into proper alignment with our God. Today, because we have accepted him as our Lord and Savior, somebody listen to me. That's what Paul could write. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What you have in you, no man can deny it. What you got the power to do, nothing can stop it. We need to stop taking every look. The church has made a big mistake, prophet. We spend more time talking about the devil. The devil has a red carpet welcome in the church because everybody talking about the devil. The devil did this. The devil did that. Some of the stuff you said the devil did, he didn't. You've given the devil an Academy Award. You know, he had won the Oscar several times. Am I speaking to you? We are taking him from under our feet when we talk like that about him. He's already been defeated. Listen to me. Turn to your neighbor. Do you know the devil has already been defeated? I'm talking to people who are victorious. Yet, the Bible says, yet among all these things, we are more than conquerors. And we receive a surpassing victory through who? Christ, who loves us. If you're more than a conqueror, that means you can't get beat. Every time the enemy shows up, you win. Oh yeah, we'll fight, but you know you've already lost. How many of you had little brothers like that? Little brothers and sisters. They know they can't beat you, but they will try. But tonight, hear me. God created you with an identity unlike any other. You're the only part of all creation that has the ability to think, the ability to talk, the ability to command, the ability to rule. And the Lord has given you full authority to do it here in the earth realm because you now are the Lord of this. And what Christ did on the cross has now returned your rightful place back to you. Walk in it. Now, if you agree with me, come on, put your hands together. Let's welcome our prophet. Come on. Glory to God.